हॅलो फ्रेंड्स, मायसेल्फ डॉक्टर व्ही एन देशमुख, असोसिएट प्रोफेसर सुधाकरराव नाईक इन्स्टिट्यूट ऑफ फार्मसी पुसद. फ्रेंड्स, टुडे वी विल लर्न अबाउट इल्युसिडेशन ऑफ बायोसिंथेटिक पाथवे. इन दिस केस वी विल स्टडी द ट्रेसर टेक्निक. इन केस ऑफ द इल्युसिडेशन ऑफ द बायोसिंथेटिक पाथवे, द बायोजेनेटिक हायपोथेसिस इज converted to biosynthetic demonstration. That is, one can know which is the precursor which is used for the biosynthesis of the particular secondary metabolites, which is the pathway step by step performed during the biosynthesis of the secondary metabolites. Either it may be an alkaloid, or it may be a glycosides, or it may be a volatile oil or tanning. How the particular precursor is used and how the last secondary metabolite it is found in case of the plants. By this technique, one can also know at which site in the plant the particular secondary metabolites get biosynthesized. Either it is in the leaf, or it is in the root, or it is in the stem, or it is in the bark, or it is in the flower, or it is in the calyx or the corolla, where the particular secondary metabolite get biosynthesized in the plants can be determined by means of the elucidation of biosynthetic pathway. So, by elucidation of biosynthetic pathway, the biogenetic hypothesis turns to biosynthetic demonstration. That is, one can prove which is the particular precursor, which is the particular pathway which is used for the biosynthesis of the particular secondary metabolites. So friends, we will start with the techniques for the elucidation of the biosynthetic pathways. The biosynthetic pathways, that is, in this case, it proves the biogenetic hypothesis to biosynthetic demonstration. So in this case, the tracer technique, use of isolated organs and tissues, grafting methods, and use of mutant strains, they are used for the elucidation of the biosynthetic pathway. In all these cases, the tracer technique, it is a main technique which is used for the elucidation of the biosynthetic pathway, in which the radioactive isotopes, they are used for the elucidation of the biosynthetic pathway. So, the tracer, first of all, we will study regarding the tracer technique. One of the example of the tracer technique, that is, during the process of the photosynthesis, in case of the dark reaction, the D-ribulose-1,5-diphosphate get converted to inidol during the dark cycle, during the Calvin cycle. So, it causes the D-ribulose-1,5-diphosphate, it causes the fixation of the carbon dioxide. So there are the two views, that is, either the carbon dioxide is taken from the atmosphere, or the carbon dioxide is taken from the internal source. So for this purpose, the plant which is to be studied, it is placed in the environment which is in which the carbon of the carbon dioxide, it is labeled one with the radioactive isotope. And further, it is seen that the label carbon is present in the next step. And also, it is observed in case of the phosphoglyceric acid. This indicates that is, the carbon dioxide, it is obtained from the atmosphere. It is taken from the atmosphere as a source of the carbon, and it is used. None other source than the atmospheric source, it is used as a source of carbon. In the other method, it is applied. In that case, you can see that if the atmospheric carbon dioxide is not provided, then there is no formation of the phosphoglyceric acid, there is no carbon dioxide present. So in this way, by using the radioactive isotope, one can determine the which component or which pathway or from where the particular precursor or particular component is taken for the completion of the synthesis of the particular secondary metabolites or the primary metabolites. So the tracer technique, various label compounds are generally utilized in case of the tracer technique. Unstable radioactive isotopes are commonly employed to label the intermediates, the unstable radioactive isotopes which will emit the radiation. If they are the unstable, they will emit the radiation, and such unstable radioisotopes, they are used for the labeling of the intermediates. The radioactive properties, that is the half-life of the radioisotope do not change when it is chemically bound to the molecule. This radioisotope do not change, that is, it does not change its emission of the radiation when it is bound to the molecule. It is possible to detect the radioisotopes incorporated to the presumed precursor, and it can be detected easily. So the number of the radioactive isotopes of the common stable elements are found in the nature, or these isotopes can be artificially produced through the use of nuclear reactors. So these radioactive isotopes, they are available in the nature, or if we want to prepare them, they can be prepared in the nuclear reactors. Beta particles are the negatively or positively charged particles of a negligible mass equivalent to electrons and positrons. Gamma radiations are a short wavelength radiation produced by radioisotopes during the decay process. So radioactive isotopes uses the biogenetic, which are used in case of the biogenetic studies, they are the tritium-3, carbon-14, sulfur-35, phosphorus-32 and iodine-131. So the half-life, it is shown that is tritium is 12.43, carbon it is 5730 years, so it is very large. So generally the carbon dioxide, it is prefer rest. In case of the sulfur, phosphorus and iodine, it is less. So generally the carbon dioxide, it is a prefer radioisotope which is used for the study. The toxicity is also medium and it discharge weak beta emissions. So as compared to the other radioactive isotope, the carbon, it is used widely. If the carbon is not suitable, then one can go for the other radioisotopes. So tritium, only radioactive isotope of the hydrogen which is found in trace amount in nature. It can be readily produced by neutron bombardment of the lower hydrogen isotope. Tritium gas can easily be converted into reagents for labeling of the precursor. Then C14, that is the carbon-14, commercially available as an barium carbonate, 14C, used as a starting material for the preparation of variety of the simple 40C label reagents, and the carbon-40, it is used widely. Whereas the radioisotopes of the sulfur, phosphorus, iodine and of the other elements are also commercially available, but use is observed only limited cases of the studied where the carbon is not feasible, where then the sulfur, phosphorus or iodine, it is used. The carbon, it is used widely. Then criteria for the selection of the radioactive isotope, that is the half-life. The half-life should be more, because it will take years and year for the studying of the elucidation of the biosynthetic pathway. So the half-life period should be long. Then its specificity for the study of particular metabolite site. So it should be specific and it should remain adhere. It should be non-toxic. It should be non-reactive, so that it can be remain attached to a particular metabolic site. Its non-damaging nature when it is fed to the system for the study. It should not damage. That is, one can say that it should be inert in nature. It should not damage to the biological system. 14C is preferred because of the large half-life. The 14C has a large half-life, so it is more preferred radioactive isotope. The tracer should be used in sufficient concentration to withstand the dilution in the long course of the metabolism. So this tracer should be used in the sufficient concentration so that it will remain in the dilution for the long time with the small dilution. The physical and chemical nature of the metabolite should be clear, and the trace must retain its position in a molecule in which it is incorporated. So the physical chemical nature should be remain as it is. It should not change when it will come in the biological environment. Then introduction of the label compounds. The label compounds can be introduced into the biological system by five different methods. First one, that is the root and stem feeding method. Next one is the direct injection method. Third one, wick feeding method. Fourth one, floating method. And fifth one is the spraying method. So first of all, we will see about the root and stem feeding method. Root and stem feeding method, common method, depending on the site of the biosynthesis of particular metabolite. For the study of tobacco alkaloids, root feeding is preferred as the roots are the biosynthetic site. That is, in case of the tobacco plant, the biosynthesis of the nicotine alkaloid takes place in the root. So the root feeding is to be done. In case of the stem feeding, the stems are cut under the water to avoid the blockage of the transpiration, and the substrate is administered through the cut ends of the stems immersed in the solution. That is, you have to cut it and immerse into the solution of the radioactive isotope so that the absorption of the radioactive isotopes will be done in the biological system. Next one, direct injection method. In this case, it is adopted for the plants with hollow stems or for the capsular fruits such as opium poppy, or in case of the papaya, the direct injection, that is the radioactive solution of the radioactive isotope, it is taken in the injection and directly placed into the hollow stem of the plant. That is the direct injection method. Third one, that is the wick feeding method. As in this case, the wick of the cotton is prepared. One end is placed into the cavity made in the stem or the root of the plant, and another end it is placed into the radioactive isotope. So successful method for the plants growing in the soil, the strands of the cotton are penetrated through the plant stem and the ends are immersed in the solution which gets infiltrated through the wick, and the absorption of the solution or the radioactive isotope solution will take place through the wick into the biological system, that is in the plants. Then floating method. In case of the floating method, the material like leaf in the form of the disc or the chopped pieces are floated on the substrate solution. That is, the leaf, it is cut and it is placed in the solution of the substrate so that through the cut portion, the absorption of the radioactive isotope will be taken into the plants. Last one, that is the spraying method. The compounds get absorbed after being sprayed on the leaves. That is, the solution of isotope is prepared and it is sprayed over the leaves. From the surface of the leaves, the absorption will be take place into the plants. So in this way, the radioactive isotopes can be introduced into the biological system. Detection and the assay of these radioactive label compounds. After the introduction of these radioactive components in the plants, the study, that is, the particular portion of the plant is taken, it is extracted by using a suitable solvent, and it is determined for the presence or the absence of the radioactive isotopes. And this determination of this radioactive isotope, it is done by the different instruments or the detectors such as the Jaeger-Müller counter. Next one, it is the autoradiography. Third one is the scintillator counter. Fourth one, liquid scintillation media. Then the gas ionization chamber. Then the Burstein Ballantine counter, mass spectroscopy, and the NMR spectroscopy. These are the detectors which are used for the detection of the radioactive isotopes, the label compound. So by these detectors, the detection of the radioactive isotope, either it is present or absent, it is done in the extract which is made from the plant. Then procedure for the elucidation. Specific radioisotope commercially available in the form of specific reagent can be directly used. The radioactive isotopes, they are available in the market. If they are not available in the market, then you have to prepare it. Many amino acids are obtained from the hydrolysis of the protein derived from the chlorella grown in the atmosphere containing 14 CO2. All the carbon compounds of the organism become labeled with the 14C. Barium carbonate 14C is used to release the 14 CO2. Sometimes the barium carbonate 14C, it is used to release the 14 CO2. So in this way, the procedures for the elucidations, they are followed up. So in this case, the tritium labeling is effected by the catalytic exchange, that is platinum catalyst in the glacial acetic acid and in the aqueous media by hydrogenation of unsaturated compounds in the tritium. So the preparation of tritium ring label, the DL conine is given. So in this case, the conine, it is labeled with the tritium. It is labeled with the tritium. So in this case, the conine, it is labeled with the tritium. All the carbons, they are labeled with the tritium. So in this way, the labeling can be done. The examples for the elucidation of the metabolic pathways in case of the plants. Most of the biosynthetic pathways which have been well explored consist of the major building blocks such as the acetate, mevalonate and the sigmate. After structural elucidation, it's usually possible to propose biogenesis for the particular precursor species. Administration of the label precursor to the organism producing the metabolite is done. The metabolites are isolated, purified, analyzed for the isotopic content, and if incorporations of the label isotope has take place, precursor metabolite relationship can be established. So if the label component is found, if the precursor is labeled and that same label component it is found in the end product, we can say that the particular precursor, it is used for the biosynthesis of that particular secondary metabolites. So in this way, the radioactive isotopes can be used for the determination of the biosynthetic pathway or for the elucidation of the biosynthetic pathway. It may then be possible to suggest a probable biosynthetic pathway for the precursor to the metabolites. It can be further be tested by incorporation of a stereospecifically labeled precursor. Suppose this A is the precursor which is a label, then from the A, the component B is formed, C is formed, then formation of X, it is also a label one, and the Z is label. Y is not label 1. Y is not label 1. So one can say that from A, B, C, D up to X, and from X directly the formation of the Z takes place. Formation of the component Z takes place. So this indicates that this is the pathway. This is the pathway, that is X to Z. It is the pathway is not X, Y, Z, but it is directly X to Z. If A, a small precursor species, is isotopically labeled and administered, B, C, 2, X and Y may be labeled in turn and used finally as and last precursor to the metabolite Z. If all these are labeled and if any one component is not labeled, one can say that it is not a pathway, the pathway is direct X to Z. In this way, biogenetic hypothesis become a biosynthetic demonstration. More careful study of 14C labeling of the sugars produced during a short period of the photosynthesis permitted Calvin to postulate the new reaction of the carboxylation of the rubulose 1,5-diphosphate, that is during the Calvin cycle, the formation of the carbohydrates takes place, but the carbon, where the carbon comes, where the carbon dioxide comes, the carbon comes from the carbon dioxide and the carbon dioxide comes from the atmosphere. Very complex phase of the carboxylation has confirmed that it involves the carboxylation not of two carbon compounds but of the 5-carbon compound ribulose 1,5-diphosphate to yield 2 moles of phosphoglyceric acid. So as already we have seen this example, that is D-ribulose 1,5-diphosphate, it is the acceptor of the carbon. Then the plant, it is placed in the atmosphere of the carbon dioxide which is labeled with the 14C, and it is the next component which is formed, it is also a label one, and this phosphoglyceric acid, it is also a label one. So one can say that the path for the biosynthesis, it is this one for the formation of phosphoglyceric acid and the carbon dioxide, it is used from the nature. This is not a pathway, where the label carbon dioxide, it is not given. And if the carbon dioxide, it is not given from the outer source, here there is no formation of the phosphoglyceric acid will take place. So the phase of carboxylation according to tracer study will indicate, that is how the particular components, they are formed in the plants. The source of carbon in photosynthesis for the conversion of the pentose to 2 molecules of phosphoglyceric acid is from the atmospheric carbon dioxide. It was studied by incorporation of the label material and confirmed that the carbon in carboxylation is coming from the atmospheric carbon dioxide. The atmospheric carbon dioxide, it is used and for the formation of the carbohydrates and not from any other internal plant source. Examples of the conine and conicin alkaloid of hemlock indicates the total change of the previous hypothesis. Conine was considered to be biosynthesis from the lysine. Previously, it is considered that is conine get biosynthesized from the lysine. Lysine is used as a precursor. It has been confirmed that both of these alkaloids are produced through totally different polyketide pathway. It has been biosynthesized by the total different polyketide pathway. So in this case, when the 14C of the acetate is labeled, when it is labeled and observed, it is further observed, you can see that the label carbon, it is not present in any of the compound. The label carbon, it is not present in any of the compound. This indicates that the lysine is not used as a precursor. The precursor is another, that is a polyketide pathway. So in this way, one can determine, one can confirm which is the precursor which is used by labeling the particular carbon which is present in that particular compound with the 14C. The C5N subunit of cedamine is often derived from lysine. In a specific fusion, when 14C and tritium double label lysine are fed, only one carbon atom of the alkaloid is labeled and no loss of the tritium was observed, indicating the involvement of non-labeled nitrogen in the formation of ring. So in this case, this carbon is labeled, this nitrogen is labeled, carbon is labeled and nitrogen is labile in case of the lysine, and the formation of the cetamine will takes place. The formation of the cetamine. So here the this carbon, it is again label 1, but the nitrogen, it is non-label. The nitrogen is not label. Tritium is present. So this indicate that this nitrogen it is not used for the formation of ring, but here this nitrogen, it is used for the formation of the cetamine ring. So by the labeling, one can know which component it is used for the formation of the ring. The biogenesis of anabasin alkaloid from the double layer lysine proved that which nitrogen of lysine molecule was involved in the formation of the piperidine ring in anabasin of the Nicotinia glauca. Non-equivalence of two nitrogens is demonstrated by feeding experiments with 16, 15 and label lysine and 2, 15 and lysine. The nitrogen atom attached to C6 was retained instead of the C2 nitrogen. That is, in this case, this carbon is label, this nitrogen is label, and the from the lysine, the formation of anabasin takes place. So in this case, this carbon and this nitrogen is label, which will indicate the formation of anabasis from the lysine. But in this case, one, this carbon is label, this nitrogen is label, and in anabasin the carbon is found, but the nitrogen, it is a non-label. This will indicate that this nitrogen, it is used for the formation of ring, and the another nitrogen, that is this nitrogen, it is not used for the formation of the ring. So by means of this tracing technique, by labeling, one can know the particular component. Next one is the competitive feeding. In the confusing case of the biogenetic pathway of the secondary metabolites, compounds of the precursor seem to be involved in the normal route of synthesis. The experiments of the label precursor studies may give a erratic result. Competitive feeding experiments have a great value in determining which is the available intermediate is used in the precursor by the plant. The normal intermediate for the compound C from compound A may be either B or B1. So in this case, which intermediate it is used? Either the precursor B or the B1, or the B1 it is used. Which precursor is used for the completion of pathway? So in such condition, both the precursors are fed separately along the label A. If a radioactivity is observed in the group receiving a precursor B and not B1, receiving group A, B, C may be concluded as a pathway from A to C. So the pathway will be concluded as an A, B, C if the precursor label B compound it is obtained. Then sequential analysis. Biogenetic pathways are the long sequence of related compounds. So there are the long sequence of the 10, 20 reaction, 25 reaction, 30 reactions. So in the plant, if the plant is grown in an atmosphere of 14 CO2 and subjected to analysis of the plant metabolites after a specific time period, it may give an idea about the sequence in which related compounds become labeled. For example, in case of the mentha piperata, when it is exposed to 14 CO2 for about 5 minutes, provided the evidence of a probable biosynthetic sequence, that is the piperitone to menthone to menthol. So in this way, the sequence can be found, and in all these components, the label carbon can be seen. Such experiments have also proven a sequential biogenesis of a thebaine, codeine, morphine in case of the Papaver somniferum. Then the use of the isolated organs, tissues and the cells. The cultures of the organs, tissues and the cells growing under the controlled aseptic conditions can be used for the feeding experiment. That is, this is performed in the tissue culture laboratory. The radioactive tracers can be introduced by this process to the parenchymatous tissues of the shoots, leaves, roots or other plant structures, and the further analysis of such plant material can provide the important informations about the incorporation of the label compounds for the determination of the site of the synthesis of the particular components. So in this case, for this study, the isolated shoot, root, stem, bark, leaf or the flower or the petals of the flower, or sometimes the stamens and the stylus, they are also used, which will determine in which particular part the biosynthesis of the particular secondary metabolites takes place. In this case, the isolated shoots and the leaves can be maintained in suitable sterile medium for the studies on case of the Nicotinia and Datura species. In both these cases, the roots is the site for the biosynthesis of the secondary metabolites. In such types of the studies on the rooted leaves, to get a large organization of the root facilitates the study to the tobacco alkaloid for the biogenetic sites, which is generally considered to be root. So by means of the root culture, number of the roots can be obtained, a cluster of the roots can be obtained, which can be used for the further study. But only it is possible, that is, you have to choose the root when the biosynthesis of the particular secondary metabolite takes place in the roots. Isolated roots are also extensively used for the elucidation of the biogenetic pathway for the tropane alkaloids in the roots of the solanaceous plants. The studies of the petal disc have been used for the elucidation of the pathways for the essential oil components such as the rose oil. In this case, the petals can be used in case of the volatile oils of the rose. Next technique for the elucidation of the biosynthetic pathway, it is a grafting method. Grafting is an operation in which two cut surfaces of the different but closely related plant place so as to unite and further grow together. This grafting technique, it is widely used in case of the horticulture, in case of the floriculture. This grafting technique, it is used. The major part which is used for the grafting, it is called as the stalk, while the portion cut off from another plant, it is called as the scions or the graft. The major portion, that is the root portion, it is called as the stalk, and the upper portion which is place of the other plant, closely related plant, it is called as the scions or the graft. In the cases of the plant propagation, grafting has an important place, and many plants like a cinchona, citrus, myristica have been successfully grafted for the production of better quality drug. Grafting has also considered utility in the biosynthetic studies for the elucidation of the pathways used for the biogenesis of secondary metabolites. Solanaceous plant like Nicotinia, Datura have been intensively studied for the tobacco alkaloids and the tropane alkaloid, the scions of the tomato grafted on the stalk of the Datura. That is, the scions of the tomato when grafted on the stalk of Datura shows the accumulation of the tropane alkaloid. So the accumulation of the tropane alkaloid in the leaf of the tomato or in the fruit of the tomato. On the contrary, when Datura scions are grafted on the tomato stalk, the production of tropane alkaloid does not occur and shows only the traces of alkaloid. This indicates the possibility that the major site of the biogenesis of the tropane alkaloid is the root and no other organ of the Datura. In the grafting experiment of the Datura ferox and the Datura stramonium demonstrated certain changes in the alkaloid, especially in aerial parts. So depending upon which part, or one can, by means of the grafting, one can know in which part particular secondary metabolites get biosynthesized in the plants. Next one is the mutant stain for the illustration of the biosynthetic pathway. Mutant stains of the lower plants like the fungi and the microorganisms are produced in the nature which lacks one or more enzyme, because of which the normal metabolic pathway are generally affected. In such mutant stains, metabolites are found at the intermediate stage and needs artificial supply of another intermediate. Such mutant stains can be used in the biosynthetic studies for the natural product. So the mutant stains, that is the changes takes place at the genetic level, one of the precursor, it is not available, so the biosynthesis does not get completed. So the precursor, it is supplied to the plant artificially to complete the biosynthesis of that particular secondary metabolites. Very interesting result have been obtained by the studies on the ultraviolet induced strains of the Claviceps purpurei, that is in the biosynthesis of the ergotamine from the ergot alkaloid. These mutant strains can produce number of amino acids of the diverse nature. When the rye plant is inoculated with the spore culture of these mutant strains, the sclerotoria demonstrate the blockage of the biogenetic pathway of the certain intermediate and the accumulation of the specific alkaloid or its intermediate compound. Then the another example is the chanoclavin 1 and its aldehyde derivatives were observed to be the accumulated in the ergotoxin producing the Digitalis purpurea mutant stains. It was found to be due to the blockage at the stage of ergoclavin formation. When two such strains, ergoclavin and other intermediates, has been supplied artificially, indicate the reinstallation, that is again the pathway will get reinstallation of the normal pathway to produce its alkaloidal compound. So in this way one can illustrate the biosynthetic pathway by using the tracer technique, by using the isolated organ cells and the tissues, then by using the mutant stains of the plants, or by using the grafting technique, one can elucidate the biosynthetic pathway. Thank you very much.